Welcome to Dawai Kudroen. My guest tonight is Honorable Finance Minister Namgay Dorji. Sir, thank you so much for your time. Without wasting much time, straight away, let's start with the first issue. As we already started in Jonka session, I think one issue that we need to clarify, you need to clarify, is on the budget cuts. So many gaps actually came on BBS. And through different forums, they raised their concerns that this government has slashed lots of their budget. So you had explanations on this in Jonka session, if you could continue doing that.
A very good evening to all the viewers. And then thank you very much to PBS and having got this opportunity to clarify on the budget and also so many issues after the recent parliament. Particularly on the tax and the salary. So yes. Today I thought this would be a very good opportunity.
Yes.
Firstly, I think there seemed to have been a confusion, which shouldn't have been, because I've already clarified in the assembly. This time, we have changed slightly in the modality of the budget. So that's why I think now the Gihok seems to have confused slightly on the budget ceilings.
Yes.
Now, in capital, there's a slight decrease in the ceiling. All because we have two things. One, we have not incorporated 1.2 billion of STP, which are all for local government. On that, 55 million we have kept aside from RJOB in the under the Ministry of Agriculture, to be implemented for the farm road on a new modality. Once the new modality is in place, we are going to send this 55 million to all the kiosks. And also, when we actually presented Minister of Finance, actually presented the budget in the parliament, although we have confirmed, but we have not received the money for STP from GOI.
Yes.
Now we have received. And then 1.2 billion. So if you add up all this, the local governments are going to get much more than of their ceiling.
Yes.
In fact, 247 million they are going to get over and above their ceiling.
Yes. Your Excellency, the concern raised was because they thought they are not going to get. But now, Your Excellency, just inform the nation that they are going to get. When are they going to get?
I think, firstly, we had first discussion on the STP, and the second round of discussion is going to be held in is due in the first last week of August, or probably by first week of September. Number one, on the STP part.
Yes.
Number two, on the 55 million of the farm road. The Minister of Agriculture is working seriously on the modality, and then they are now already some of the geos they have already implemented.
Yes.
So at least by first week of September we should be in full swing to implement. In fact, all the farm road that was planned in the 11th five-year plan, we are targeting to complete by the first year, second year of the 11th five-year plan.
Yes.
All because when we actually made some analysis or the studies in the farm road of the 10th five-year plan, firstly, there seem to have a lot of compromisation in the quality. Secondly, we have very limited budget for the farm road. And then we thought that contracting out, we cannot afford all because of the limited budget. And this time, we are going to send the machine. And we're going to send the that 55 million all to the local government so that they can implement with that is just for the fuel.
Yes. Your Excellency, some of the local leaders of some gyoks actually raised concern, and their concern is that they wouldn't be able to sign the compact with the government or with the local government, that is the Jongkhak, simply because they did not have enough budget, and without enough or sufficient allocation of budget, they wouldn't be able to execute the 11th five-year plan as envisioned or as expected by the government. So now, with this budget, can they go forward signing the compact?
Firstly, the Honourable Prime Minister has signed the compact agreement, and he made it very clear to all the 20 Zongkhaks that this is just starting. We may not be able to implement all that we signed. This is just what we call the concept. We're just trying to introduce in the first year.
Yes.
After that, now, after informing the nation that they're going to get the budget, I hope the local leaders will be able to sign this, number one. Number two, if they don't wish to sign, we're not making it compulsory. It all depends on the GUP. We leave it to the GUP. All that we want to do is we want to send the budget on time. We want to release the money on time. And the main objective of this compact agreement is to see to it that work is done on time.
Yes.
Now, if the local leaders feel for the reason best known to themselves, if they don't want to sign, well, it's up to the local leaders. We don't want to enforce. But I'm making it very clear that we are going to. There is enough budget. In fact, we are concerned, all because for the 10-5-year plan, we just had 148 billion, and for this we had 213 billion. And then for the capital budget outlay of the 10-5-year plan was 72, we have 92.
Yes.
And then for local government in the 10-5-year plan, that's 12 billion. We have 15 billion, 3 billion more. We are worried as to whether we can implement on time all this budget. So we're going to have enough budget, and then I hope they will cooperate with us, and then they will sign. If they don't want to sign, we don't want to enforce la.
Yes, sir. Your Excellency, should this be the case, now that you don't want to enforce it, you leave it to the local leaders, keeping it optional. If they want to sign, they can. If they don't want to, it's up to them. Now, if this is the case, then why have this compact agreement at all? Because if you're leaving it to the local leaders, to their whims and fancies, it seems to us that this compact agreement does not seem to be serious. Because even if you fail, there's no penalty, there's no any possible consequences. So why have it?
But we would view it seriously. Firstly, we have the Honourable Prime Minister has already signed with the Zongdas, and we have also planning to sign in the second year. Now the penalty for the local leaders, if they don't wish to sign after having sent a budget, and if they don't implement, and if they are not able to implement the budget that we have sent to them, then I think the people are going to lose. We are making that, all the local leaders sign, but we have no laws to make them sign. But if they don't sign after releasing the budget, if they don't sign, even without signing, if they can complete, well, this is a very good thing that we would like to congratulate for them. Without even, the whole aim is to sign the compact agreement, all because we want to implement all the development activities as per the plan in the GIO. Without having to sign, if they can complete, that's a very good sign.
It's just a subtle reminder.
Yes.
And no accountability fixation there, right?
Now, if they don't sign, and if they don't complete their work on time, the budget is going to lapse, and then people are going to lose. Therefore, I think the local leaders have the moral duty to sign and work for the benefit of the people.
Yes.
It's up to the people. If they don't sign, if the local leader don't sign, and if they don't, if they cannot achieve the target of their GIO, their people are going to lose.
Yes, sir. Your Excellency, to move on, tax. Now, in Zongkha session, Your Excellency mentioned that media should also support the taxation policy of the government. The best support we can give you is by having Honourable Finance Minister, or for that matter, anyone from the government here, and ask some critical questions so that you can explain to the people. And one such question would be that the whole concept or idea of taxation is to get from the rich and give it to the poor. But today when you look at, especially looking at two taxes levied, one on fossil fuel and other on telecommunications, this is going to hit everyone indiscriminately. So did you have any consultative process while coming out with these two taxation methods, policies?
Well, firstly, I think the entire nation, although I have mentioned or I have submitted in the parliament, due to time constraints, we are not. I have not been able to talk in detail and justify why we are revising the tax. Number one, the huge current account deficit because of the balance of payment. Because we are importing in 2013 only, we are importing like 51 billion. And then we are exporting something like 35 billion, and we have a deficit about 19 billion. Now, because of this, I think the previous government borrowed a huge short-term borrowing just to support the current account deficit. And then after a while, they couldn't go ahead, and therefore they had to ban like furniture, vehicle, and then the alcohol, all because of the current account deficit. Today, you'll be shocked to know that in 18 months, the government has when we paid the short-term borrowing, SBI, Punjab Bank, and then the currencies of arrangement with the GOI, we have paid 18.9 billion for that. Just for the interest, we have paid 1.7 billion. This is, I think, equivalent to the first year local government budget of the 20 and 205 gyoks. Imagine that. Now, if you can't, it's all because of the import. Now, if people wish and if people don't support this tax revision, we have no choice either to ban all these items. And then with ban, firstly, it is not as per international norms, number one. It is not a conventional thing to ban such an item for a long time, number one. Number two, if you don't ban, then the only way to help is to revise the tax so that we could restrict the import. Now, if people don't support, then we may have to reduce the tax and let it go. Then I don't think we can have any development activities, because whatever resources that we have, whatever income that we have, is all will be consumed by interest of the short term, the rupee that we borrow from for just to balance the current account deficit.
Yes.
Number one. And now the rich and the poor. I think the taxation, that progressive taxation that we have, is fairly internationally accepted norms. For instance, when you talk of the fuel, for a rural farmer, I think if you work out, the best example would be from Pinsling and Thimphu. I think the bus fare will be increased because of the fuel about 4 rupees. Now, talk about a contractor. He has about 20 trucks. If he has a company, firstly, in a month, I think he'll be paying about 1,50,000 just for the fuel raise. Whereas an ordinary citizen is just going to pay how much? Maybe about 4 rupees. For him, firstly, he is paying more on the more on his fuel, number one. Number two, then he has to file BIT. Number three, he has to file PIT. For an ordinary, you just have to pay 4 rupees. And for a bag of rice, when you actually make, I have made an analysis, and then when I work out, I think the bag of rice is going to cost just about 1 rupee more, because actual the implication on the cost of the fuel is about 145 or 150 rupees from Pinsling to Thimphu.
Yes.
The truck can carry about 250 bags of rice. If you divide, the actual inflation would be 1 rupee. But see, for those people who use so much trucking business for contract, they'll be paying, definitely they'll be paying more. So more than that, what can we have?
So, Your Excellency, are you saying that common people or poor people should not be worried about inflation?
They shouldn't be. For instance, for average civil service, when I worked out, I think they spend about 3,500 just for fuel. That's about 51 liters. So after the revision, I think they'll be spending about 150. This is average. 150, something which any civil service can afford to spend. And number one. Number two, the main reason why we had to put green tax on the fuel is that fuel price difference between Penang or in Bhutan and India, because of the sales tax and VAT in the neighboring states. Now, you can imagine there's a difference of 12.8 newton difference between petrol price in Penang and Hashimarala. So now, the petrol, we have to borrow rupee, pay 10% interest, import fuel, and then because of the price difference, because of the price difference in Bhutan and India, there's so much deflation of the fuel.
So what would be the price difference now?
Now, I think petrol is about 9, because we have diesel is about 1.9 only.
Yes.
Earlier, I think there was diesel, I think there was a difference about 3 point something. Now, after revising, when we have revised by about 2.57 in diesel, so now I think there's 1.9 only the difference in the diesel. And in petrol, we still have 9.2
newton. 9 is still quite
there's
high.
A difference. Yes.
It's quite high level.
Yes.
So we're quite sure that our neighbors would come and fuel their cars.
Yeah.
In our fuel depot. Now, given that situation, this deflection issue cannot be solved. So, can government think of any other alternatives so that the neighbors coming to our fuel depots to fuel their cars can be completely stopped?
Well, I think there's not much we can do about it. And for the last 1 year before the parliament, we tried to do some studies, but there's not much we can do except to raise the fuel. And then once we raise the fuel, see the repercussion that we have and the resistance from the people. Because we have the free trade, and then we have to respect. Besides this, I don't think there's any practical way to equate the price. Let's see how we would, and we will be just monitoring how much we are importing in the fuel, and then let's see what we can do in near future.
Yes. Your Excellency, now, earlier you mentioned about the concerns that we should all have regarding our national debt. What would be the current status or current stand of our debt?
I think the long-term debt as of June 2014 is about 108 billion. And that right now the debt that I'm talking is about the short-term.
Yes.
Today we have 24.9 billion current account deficit. That means we need that much rupee to balance our current account deficit. Despite the fact that we pay 18.9 billion with interest of 1.7 billion rupee. I think it's important once again to mention that just for interest for current account short-term borrowing, we have spent the budget of local government the first year of the 10th five-year plan, 1.7 billion. And then first year, the total budget outlay for local government was 1.9. So very close. So now I'm saying that there was a ban. Unless we revise the tax and then we restrict the import, there's not much we can do. Either you ban all these items and inconvenience all the people, or you revise the tax to such extent that we can restrict, and if not, we can reduce the tax. We will not ban any items, but we will be paying heavy price. So that means probably we will not be able to implement our plan on time. Whatever savings, whatever revenue that we generate, we'll all end up paying in the interest of the short-term borrowing only. The choice is for the people.
Yes. Your Excellency, now, Your Excellency earlier mentioned that ban is not a good option. And even in the past, we have had so many people talking about ban not being a good option, especially in a democratic setup. Now, if you're not going for ban, by lifting the ban and levying heavy taxes, for instance, you talk about vehicles. For vehicles, you levy heavy taxes, but we do not have internal production of these cars. We have to import all these cars. That would again mean that you are sending out rupee.
Yes.
So how can this situation help rupee debts that we have? Help in solving the rupee debts we have?
Well, the simple answer is the tax difference, the tax percentage that we impose would help to pay the interest of the current account. For instance, now when you're talking about that time you mentioned about the rich and the poor. For instance, for our rural farmers, we have just kept 5% sales tax. Total, they'll be paying just 15% for Bolero utility. This is a help to our rural people. Now, equivalent to this, for the Land Cruiser, we have 180% tax. From 70 was existing, and in addition to that, we have added 110. So total, they'll be paying 180. Despite the fact of 180, if people still want to buy a Land Cruiser, so that 180% of the tax would help definitely to pay the interest of the current the rupee that we borrow. For the ordinary people, passenger buses, we have not raised. And for the middle income people, for instance, when you talk about Alto and Santro, there was already existing of 25 la sales tax to us. Custom duty, you don't have to pay.
No.
Sales tax was 20, green tax was 5 la. So total, till now you have been paying 25 la. On that, now we have added 30% sales tax. So total, you will be paying 55. Now for the same car in Nepal, you are paying actually 225. And by the way, our neighbor like Nepal, they have surplus current account deficit.
Yes.
So they have surplus current account balance la. We have deficit of 24.9 billion. And in the 11-5-year plan, we have just for our capital, 92 billion. And we have to meet our target. Imagine when we have to complete our development activities on time, the import that we need to do. And this is something which is unavoidable. We have to import to complete our work on time.
Yes.
And then I can't imagine the current account deficit that will shoot up.
Yes, Your Excellency, pardon me for my layman's thinking again, but just a follow-up question to this. I'm a bit confused as to how the rupee situation can be solved by taxation again, because you're not taxing the people on rupee. You're not taxing people to pay in rupee. People are paying in Ultram as tax, and what people need is rupee from the government that will flow out to buy cars. So how will that solve rupee issue?
Firstly, when you impose heavy tax, that means the cars have become expensive.
Yes.
So therefore, people will refrain in buying cars. That means unless you have extra money, people will think twice to buy. For instance, if you talk about the Land Cruiser, earlier was 70%. Now today, 180%. So to own a Land Cruiser, I think you have to pay something like 1 crore 20 lakhs or so.
So this is a smarter way of band.
Now, yes. Now the difference that they pay will be able to back up the interest that we pay for the rupee that we borrow.
Yes.
Are you getting me? La?
No, sir. No, sir. Sir, now, one issue is that you pay, you levy heavy taxes on the vehicles, and you also tax fuel. And I think I raised this question last time as well to Your Excellency as a follow-up, because now people want me to ask this question. I receive so many mails. All these policies are geared towards promoting electric cars. Promoting electric cars is a good thing to do for the government or for any individual if it is a first-hand car. But you are promoting second-hand electric cars. What do you think of this?
Well, firstly, I'm quite surprised because the electric car was already promoted before actually PDP formed the government.
Yes. Now, but the promotion was not that vigorous.
The government, there was no tax, number one. Number two, I think it was left to the people.
Yes.
If people had the energy, if there was a political will, then they would have been.
Yes.
But this time, when actually we are trying to, because of the heavy import, particularly on the fuel, because fuel, as I mentioned, just in 1 year for 2013, we have 7.4 billion import of fuel. We have just rupee from the hydropower, 11 point something. That leaves us, the import was about 19 billion, and the import deficit was about 19 billion. That leaves straight away for just 2013, about 6 billion.
Yes.
Minus current account, further deficit of by 6 billion. Now, again, coming back to the e-cars. Well, this was a policy already there,
yes.
Number one. Number two, if I think we are making, firstly, we are not making compulsory for people to buy.
Yes.
And then also, there was a lot of debate on the e-cars to levy tax. But as it is, e-cars are expensive. I think it costs about 14 lakhs.
Yes.
If you levy the tax on that, I think it's just going to be a lip service of promoting this policy because nobody could afford it. And number three, when we don't impose, there is an attraction. Because there's no tax, people have that urge to buy. Now, for instance, I think the supplier, they imported about 29. All 29 cars have been sold, number one. So that will definitely help to reduce the import of fuel, number one. Number two, yes, second-hand, but it's very clear that second-hand cars are not allowed in the country. That all because of the environmental concern. Because when you buy second-hand car, that has a negative impact on the environment. All because of the emission that the second-hand cars. But for the e-car, when there is no emission, I don't think there's any problem to encourage second-hand cars. And second-hand cars, we are just making it not for anybody. It is only for the taxi. Of course, we are receiving a lot of requests, but we said no. It is for only for the taxi so that our common people can benefit.
Yes.
We are receiving so many requests for the second-hand e-car to be bought by civil service and then the people across the nation. They want to buy a second-hand car,
yes,
e-car. But we said it is only for taxi drivers.
Yes, sir. Second-hand cars would be cheaper. But again, the concern is, Your Excellency said there will be no impact on the environment because of second-hand e-cars. What about the batteries? Because there are some people who feel that Bhutan might soon become a dump yard of all the second-hand cars.
Well, for the fossil fuel, we have emission from the fuel, burning of the fuel, number one. We also have the battery. Without battery, no fuel, fossil fuel car runs. So battery is already there. Now, for this e-car, I don't think that would become a dumping ground, number one. Firstly, this is a new product that we are encouraging. Secondly,
yes,
new e-cars are going to be expensive and then not many people can afford to buy. Equivalent car, people can still buy, for instance, even after raising the tax. Now the equivalent car, the tax is about 55 because it's Alto and then the Santro, you'll be paying 55. So you still can afford to buy those cars for 5 lakhs plus 6 lakhs, at the most, within 6 lakhs. So there won't be many who can afford to buy e-cars.
Yes.
For taxi, we just have limited numbers. So I don't actually quite agree because second-hand is very limited number that we are going to import. And then that is only just for the taxis. And then, how can you say that we are going to have a dumping ground? Because firstly, new cars, not many people can afford to buy. For second-hand, for the taxis, it's very limited number. And then, therefore, I don't think we can make this country a dumping ground for with the battery.
We would like to move on. Not much time left. The technical mistake on the utility car, tax on the utility cars. What went wrong? You have a dynamic team in your ministry. was there a need for the ministry to come up with this technical mistake? Because once it was out after the deliberations in the parliament, and then you come up with mistakes like this, people even had to come to Thimphu for appealing not to levy taxes as opposed to the discussion in the parliament. What went wrong, sir?
I think everybody makes a mistake. So there was just a HSCO number that there was a typing error. So I don't think this is a major thing. Just because people came to Thimphu, that doesn't mean that we had actually changed the number.
No, sir.
There was just a typing mistake with the, anybody can make that mistake.
When we first announced,
I think there was a mistake in the HSCO number. So later on, when we actually knew that there was a mistake in the percentage of the tax, so we just corrected la.
Yes,
so that can happen anywhere. It's just a typing mistake la.
Yes, sir. So a few more questions. One, the quotas for vehicle import for MPs can be sold, but the ones that the civil servants are going to get cannot be sold. Why this difference? Sir?
No, they can't sell.
Even MPs cannot sell?
They can't sell.
No, sir.
Because if they sell, and then there's a particular clause in the sales and custom sales and customs tax 2012, where it is very clear that if they sell, they'll have to pay the duty.
Yes.
They can't sell. So I don't know how people are now having opinion that they can sell. They are not allowed to sell.
Yes. So another issue is on the housing allowance. Housing allowance, I've been getting calls from school teachers, I've been getting calls from some doctors saying that they have no choice but to live in a government quarter because their duty requires them to live in a government quarter. They're given the 20% housing allowance, but whatever balance is left is going back to the government exchequer. Why is that?
Firstly, I think the housing allowance is a new policy that is being implemented in our country. Although there was some group of people, top civil servant had the privilege of enjoying the housing, 20% housing, free housing. But now that as we pledge ourselves, we have given housing loan to the entire civil service, this is a new policy. So
nice.
Therefore, for any new policy, there would be a little teething problem. Now we are receiving a lot of concerns, and then the government, the Honourable Prime Minister has instructed Minister of Finance to review this, and we are in the process of reviewing it.
Yes. So one issue is the concerns raised between the two houses and some debates happening informally between the two houses. National Council earlier had so many recommendations during the session on electric cars, second-hand electric cars, on taxation, and many other issues. But those issues, including the housing allowance that I just mentioned, those recommendations, some members felt that were not taken into account by the government. But today, you have different people raising the same issue, and government had to consider it and relook into this issue. Why is this? Is there some serious differences between the two houses?
Not at all. In a democracy, I think the debate of such nature is very good, la. And then this has been happening, and it should happen also, la.
Yes.
The recommendations of the NC was tabled in National Assembly, and we did discuss, la. And then the Assembly at that point of time, NA, had their own opinion.
Yes.
And then since this was mainly to do with the finance, in terms of monetary, so NA had a say, and then that's how it was passed, number one. Number two, now the housing allowance that is being raised by the general public, we are reviewing it.
Yes.
But at that point of time, we actually, when it comes to the housing allowance, it was based on principle of natural justice, in a sense that those people who are already enjoying, for instance, when you talk of the school principal, the most of the school principal, half the school principal in the school had the school principal quarter.
Yes.
And then half didn't have the school principal quarters. Now, when you talk about Thimphu itself, in Thimphu, some of the school had principal quarter and then some didn't. Those school where there was no school principal, they had to stay in a rented house. Now, for those who had the quarter, they already had a privilege. Now, with the 20% housing 20% housing allowance, they will further benefit. So, at the point of time when we actually discussed on this, so it was felt that it was unfair.
Yes.
Those people already they had the privilege of enjoying the housing accommodation in the principal quarter. Over and above that, they are going to get HR.
Yes.
Now, when you talk about the rural principals, I think some of the school, the quality of the school principal quarters are in a dilapidated state, and then to deduct 20% seems to be a little unfair. However, the recent decision from the cabinet is to review the housing allowance.
Yes.
To the Minister of Finance, and Minister of Finance is working on it.
Yes, sir. Your Excellency, thank you so much for your time. The best support that media or in fact BBS can offer you or your government is by having you here time and again, so that many questions are answered like you did tonight. Thank you so much again, sir. With this, we come to the end of Dawai Kudroen. Thank you so much for watching Dawai Kudroen.